Good morning, everyone. It's good to see everybody here this morning. Y'all ready to praise the Lord this morning? You ready to worship this morning? Let's all stand. We're going to sing His Love Endures Forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever.
So how long does God's love endure? Amen. Amen. Somebody was listening. Amen. Not only were you listening, I heard y'all singing this morning. Y'all sounded really, really good. Would you pray with me now, please? Every head bowed and bow your head and your hearts with me today. Father, we are so grateful that your love never, ever expires, dear Father God. We are grateful to know that it is not for a limited time only, but it is indeed forever, Father. And so we rejoice in that, God. We take hope and our confidence, dear God, is in the fact that you will never, ever ever fail us, dear God. And so, God, I just thank you so very much this morning for receiving the praise that you deserve, dear God. So may you find hearts that are here at Black Rock that are hungry, dear God, to give you the praise that you so rightfully deserve. And so, God, also, God, I pray that you'd also, God, not just find certain hearts, but may you fill hearts today with your love, dear God. Perhaps there is somebody here searching for a love that that knows no limits, dear God. May they be introduced to you today, dear God. Fill them with the hope of Jesus. And so, God, I'll thank you for how you will bless. God, I know you can do this. And God, you can do so much more than this. So may you just take control of this service, dear God. And we'll praise you for whatever takes place. God, the results are in your hands. Lord, we love you and we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. And if you can agree with that prayer, help me say amen. Amen. Please be seated. It is just great to be back in church today. I missed this past Wednesday with some sickness, you know, and through antibiotics and through your prayers, I'm definitely feeling better. My throat feels just a little sore. So if I start fading, I've already talked to Janice Hendricks, and she'll come up and finish preaching my message for me today. She's feeling a little confident that the Dogs won last night, so she's feeling good. I'm just kidding about all that, really all of that, about everything about that stuff. But anyways, it is good to be back here. Brother Mark Souter from Set Free, if you were not here, he filled in for me Wednesday night. And from what the word on the street is, he did a phenomenal job, so it's grateful to have people that come and fill in, because this is not my pulpit. This is God's, you know, this is God. So I thank God for the opportunity to be back with you today. A few things while I have your attention, and that is next Sunday will be our homecoming Sunday. You know, typically you go to a homecoming at a high school, they got bonfires and pep rallies and everything like that. I'm under the impression that every time we come together, that God will light a bonfire in our spirit, amen? And we can have a spiritual pep rally, not for the sake just of the emotional, but we can take something with us every single time we leave. So that is our expectation. Somebody sent a question to the church's Facebook page at a few days ago, saying, hey, are y'all having revival over there? And my response was, well, we had a meeting a few weeks ago, but we expect God to meet with us every week. So I forget my exact words, but we want an ongoing touch from God. And so anyways, homecoming next Sunday morning, what does that mean? That means we're going to do what we're doing always, have an awesome worship service put together, but we get to eat together. And all God's people said, amen. 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 So instead of going and standing in long lines and having to pay, you might just stand in a semi-long line, but you get a free lunch next Sunday. So please make plans to be here. The church will be providing, I think, what is it they're providing? I kind of forget. Oh yeah, fried chicken. I didn't forget. I'll just plane that off. So if you want other types of meats, please bring that and some other dishes to go along with that. Enough for your family, and we'll put it all together. As the old school saying is, dinner on the grounds. But don't be alarmed. It is not on the ground. It's on the table, okay? A lot of times our lingo is misconstrued, and we don't want to think it's going to be on the ground. I got to move on. But anyways, I'm wasting my voice up here. I got to save it for later. A few other things I really want to make sure that we mention, and that is tonight. But the children's choir resumes, and that is for ages 4 years through fifth grade. Also tonight resuming is sign language class at 5 o'clock, and they meet back in the men's classroom. And so I think that's where they used to meet. If not, I promise you somebody will be on the campus in the building that can direct you where they are going. And they may even give you some sign language and say, that way or that way. This is a tough crowd this morning. I tell you what, man, tough crowd this morning. So let me just move along and we'll be done this morning. Hey, we thank you for being here today. If this is your first time here at Black Rock, we are grateful to have you. I'm grateful for every person that's here today, but especially if you are a first-time guest today, we want to recognize you for being here today. And so if you're a first-time guest, would you do us the honor of raising your hands? Our deacons just got some information from our church that we want to put in your hands. Any first-time guest today? Anybody at all? All right, Miss Janice.
I would love to finish a sermon because I would get us out of here before 1:15. That's a promise. We were down in Sunday school today. We had 107, but that's okay. 107 people studying God's Word. To me, that's pretty awesome. So I'd like to encourage you to come. We do have a class for everyone. We will be starting new classes the first of the year. So if you have any ideas or you'd like to join a class, see me. I put you to work. And Brother John, I know you haven't felt good this week, and I feel bad for you for that. But this will make you feel better. When I was leaving, that service last Sunday was awesome. The 9/11 service out here was just, it was really good. So when I was on the way to my car, I was behind these two ladies, and one of them said, "This church goes all out." I was like, "All right." And they said, "Man, just the remembrance today." And the other one said, "Yeah, and they even had Barney Fife preaching the sermon today."
Thank you.
time and let's fellowship one another this morning.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. For all the love ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down at the cross. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin.
As we return to our seats, let's sing "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name."
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. And throw the diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throne we at his feet may fall. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all.
Amen. You may be seated. We'll sing "Surely Goodness and Mercy." This will be our offertory hymn.
A pilgrim was I and the wandering. In the cold night of sin I did roam. When Jesus the kind shepherd found me, and now I am home, my way home. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me and praise all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. He restoreth my soul when I'm weary. He giveth me strength day by day. He leads me beside the still waters.
surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. When I walk through the dark, lonesome valley, my Savior will walk with me there, and safely His great hand will lead me to the mansions He's going to prepare. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity and this privilege that we have to gather in your house and worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you, Lord, that we can call the Creator of the universe Father through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the Creator of all things, the one that said, "Let there be," and it was so. Lord, we thank you for the healing that you've done in our pastor's body. We thank you for restoring his voice. And Lord, we look forward this morning to hearing a word from you through him. Lord, we pray that we would have open ears, that we would have open minds, and especially we would have open and receptive hearts, that those things, Father, that you have for us to learn and to sow to our lives, that we would not only hear them, but we would practice them in our everyday walk. Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for the many blessings. We ask, Father, that your word would be planted in the depths of our heart, that it might bring forth fruit, much fruit, to your honor and to your glory. We thank you also, Lord, for the privilege that you give us to share through our tithes and offerings the ministries and the programs and the outreach of Black Rock Baptist Church. We pray, Father, that each one of us be cheerful givers and that we give in accordance with your will to further your kingdom here on earth. We ask these things in Jesus Christ's name, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
You go ahead and stand up with us. We're going to sing "Your Grace Is Enough."
It is
What you have required. search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry,
invite you this morning to please take your Bibles and find the third chapter of the very first book of the Bible, Genesis. Genesis chapter number 3. Genesis is where it all began, literally. And so once you have found your place there, and if you can physically stand, I want to invite you also to stand to your feet with me today as we honor and reverence the reading of the Word of God today. Genesis chapter number 3. Preaching on this subject, not a fan of the fall. Not a fan of the fall. Genesis 3, beginning at verse number 1. Before I read, I just want to thank our choir today, orchestra. You performed excellently today, as well as our praise team. Thank y'all so very much for that. I think about the lyrics of that last song they just did there about coming back to the heart of worship. Bottom line, I just want to convey this about the worship experience, and that is if you come to church relying on a praise team to jumpstart your worship, that tells me your worship was dead before you got here. Listen, we are to come not to get our worship, but to bring our worship to the Lord. So when we worship God all week long, that makes this worship experience that much sweeter. Is that true? I think it's a true statement. Maybe if you've never heard that before, God will make that true to you today. Genesis 3, beginning of verse 1, the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat, nor shall you touch, lest you die." Then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die. For God knows that the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, "Where are you?" So he said, "I have heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you that you should not eat?" Then the man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I ate." And the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle and more than every beast of the field. On your belly shall you go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and he shall bruise your heel." Father God, I pray that you speak deep into our hearts for Jesus' sake. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. So if you look on your calendars, if your calendar gives you notifications of upcoming events, you will note that this Thursday, September the 22nd, is the official beginning of the fall season. Who would not like fall? Can I get a witness? The weather gets cooler, football season begins, and beyond all that good stuff there, everything turned to the flavor of pumpkin. Can I get a witness? My goodness, you got pumpkin lattes, you got pumpkin coffee creamers, you've got pumpkin pies. Man, everything turns into pumpkin. You got pumpkin cologne, you got pumpkin scented toilet paper, and I made them last two up, but just give them time. That'll be on the market, I promise you, okay? And then when you see it, you know what, I know you heard it here first. You know, so while I am a fan of the fall season, there is one fall that I am not a fan of, and that was the original fall of man. And we just read about it here. Now listen, if you do not understand Genesis chapter 3, you will probably not understand the rest of your Bible. Now how can I make such a statement, and what even do I mean by that? Because I just said, if you do not grasp, if you do not understand Genesis chapter 3, you will probably not understand the rest of your Bible. Here's what I mean. In the first two chapters of our Bible, in the first two chapters of Genesis, we note that God made everything and everything was perfect. Is that right? In the first two chapters of our Bible, we will see perfect people. We will read about a perfect place, and we will see a perfect provision. That's in Genesis chapter 1 and 2. But in chapter 4, in Genesis chapter 4, you no longer have perfect people. As a matter of fact, from Genesis chapter 4 through Genesis chapter 11, here is a glimpse of what you will see. You will see jealousy. You will see anger. You will find murder. You will see lying. You will hear rebellion. And you will read of judgment. In just a few chapters, a few short chapters, and you're asking what happened. What caused the wheels to fall off humanity so quickly? And can I tell you this? Genesis chapter 3 is what happened. When you go from Genesis 2 to 4 and you see the depravity of man, you see man digress, and he's been digressing ever since then. What could cause such a cataclysmic shift in mankind? And we see that Genesis 3 is what happened. You see, in Genesis chapter number 3, make a note here that in Genesis chapter 3, sin had its very first birthday, and Adam and Eve got duped by the devil. You see, contrary to popular belief, because there is a modern day theology or philosophy floating around today that mankind actually began at the very bottom and is working his way heavenward. And you see, that's the theology and the philosophy that's being taught today, that mankind, all of us, you know, we start out at our worst, and we are eventually working our way towards God, and we are eventually working our way towards heaven. That is not what the Bible says. The Bible says just the opposite. The Bible teaches us that man was actually created, he was created at its highest, but he fell to his lowest. You see, mankind was created in the Garden of Eden, and he walked with God. He had an intimate, awesome fellowship with God every single day. So it was not that he was just getting better and better, and one day he would eventually have a relationship with God. Oh no, he had a relationship with God, and he fell off. You see, every descendant since Adam, i.e., you and me, all of us, we are all descendants of Adam, and consequently, we are all part of the ruined race. Because if your mind works like my mind, and we're thinking about, well, good night, if Adam and Eve were the first ones to do this, why don't we just call this the fall of Adam and Eve? I'd vote for that, amen, because that takes the pressure off us. But we know it's not just the fall of Adam, and it's not just the fall of Eve. This was the fall of mankind, because you need to understand from a biblical, theological standpoint that when Adam and Eve fell, all of humanity fell with them. But preacher, there was nobody else there in the garden. I get it. I understand that. But you need to understand what the Bible teaches us. What does it teach us? It teaches us in Romans chapter 5, verse 12. You may want to write this down if you are taking notes today. It says these words, "Therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because all have sinned." You see, every descendant of Adam's ruined race, all of us, but those, that's the bad news. Aren't you glad we're not just going to fold up shop and dismiss right here on that note? That's the bad news, is that every person breathing, every person living today, we are a part of that ruined race. And I'm so grateful to know that not only can I quote to you Romans 5:12, which says that every person who is a descendant of Adam are part of the ruined race. I can also tell you that I thank God that God the Holy Spirit, he penned this passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 21 and 22, which says these following words: "For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead." Watch this now. "For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive." Listen, for the first 16 years of my life, I lived my life part of Adam's ruined race. But for the last 21 years of my life, I have been living in Jesus as part of the redeemed race. No, I have not laid aside my flesh and stepped out of my flesh into a glorified body yet. I promise you, y'all listening, this is not what a glorified body looks like. And everybody said amen. Praise God for that. So listen, I am grateful to know that not only do we have to succumb to toting around a ruined and being part of the ruined race, the Bible says those who are in Christ, we are part of the redeemed race. Listen, for our remaining time this morning, I'm not going to dive in and dissect the first six verses and talk about the scheme and the bait and how the devil got to Eve and consequently Adam. And I want to fast forward to verse 7, and here's what I want to do this morning with the remaining part of our time. I want to talk about sin and the companions of sin, because we see in our text today that sin brought some companions. And here's what sin brought with, when sin was birthed on its birthday 6,000 years ago, it did not come alone. It brought along with it grief, and it brought along with it shame. And can I tell you today, and I don't have to convince any of you, you know why? Because we are all descendants of Adam, and we have all sinned. So I'm not going to waste time trying to convince you you're a sinner. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So what we will talk about today is how 6,000 years ago sin brought guilt and shame, and still currently till today, guess what sin is still doing? Sin still has the same ride along partners. Sin still has companions. Sin still brings with it guilt, and sin still brings with it shame. Notice in our text today in verse 7, the Bible says that then the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were what? They knew they were naked, and they sewed fig leaf together and made themselves coverings. Now I want to make a comparison here. I want to compare this passage to chapter number 2, verse 25. Look in your Bible just a few verses prior. Chapter 2, verse 25, that was before the fall of man. Remember, that was when there was still a perfect place, a perfect people, and a perfect provision. Notice what the inspired text says there. It says this, and they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. So before the fall of man, there was no shame. But when they fell, when they disobeyed the word of God, when Satan caused doubt in their mind and in their hearts, and they doubted the word of God, they stepped outside that boundary, and they fell spiritually and morally. And all of a sudden, prior to that, they were naked, but they had no shame. But now they are naked, and they are full of guilt, and they're full of shame. Now, I want to submit something to you today. Now, I cannot prove this. I cannot prove it at all, but I am convinced that before the fall of man, that they were actually clothed. Okay? Stay with me now. Stay with me. Listen to what the psalmist said in Psalm 104, verse 1 and 2. Because the psalmist, in this passage, he was talking about the wardrobe of God. God has a wardrobe. You get this, right? Notice what the psalmist said about the wardrobe of God. He says these words, "Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, you are very great. You are clothed with honor and majesty, who cover yourself with light as a garment, who stretch out the heavens like a curtain." So what is God clothed with, according to the text? He is clothed with light and glory. Whenever God showed up in the Old Testament, he showed up in the Shekinah glory of God. And the psalmist, under the inspiration of the Spirit of God, said, "God, you are very good, you are great." And he goes on to say, "You are clothed with light and glory." So I submit to you today that I'm convinced, can't prove it, cannot prove it, but I'm convinced that before the fall, Adam and Eve, as the Bible says in Genesis 2:25, they were naked and were not ashamed. I'm convinced they were clothed with the glory of God. I can't prove it, but I can also quote to you Romans 3:23, which says what? "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." Does that make sense in your mind now? Before the fall, the Bible says they were naked in a sense of not having clothes like we have, but they were not ashamed. But after the fall, meaning they had sinned and they had fallen short of the glory of God, so sin came in and the glory of God left. How many of you know that sin always, always, always separates us from God? It always does. And if you don't believe me, we're going to read here in a few moments in verse 8, 9, and 10 that when God stepped into the garden that day to meet Adam and Eve at whatever that set appointed time was, they jumped in the bushes. Why? Because they were attempted to hide from God. Make a mental note right there. Insert mental note. They attempted, but they were not successful at hiding from God. And I said that to say this, and I may even say it later. We also may attempt to run and hide our sin and try to hide from God. There might even be somebody here today that is a fellow Christian, but yet there is sin in your heart and your life, and you are in church trying to hide from God. I promise you this, nobody has ever successfully hid from God, so don't think you're going to be the pioneer person to actually hide from God. Okay? That wasn't even the notes, but somebody obviously needed to hear that today. So sin had stripped them of the glory and left them with a very sad story. Sin had brought guilt and shame. But listen, I thank God that it brought guilt. I thank God that it brought shame. Preacher, why would you say that? Because if we ever, notice I said we, you and me, if we ever get to the place where sin never brings us guilt and sin never brings us shame, that means our heart is hardened and our soul is not sensitive to the Spirit of God, and there is not much hope in us. Listen to what Ezra said in Ezra chapter 9, verse 6. And I said, "Oh my God, I am too ashamed and humiliated to lift up my face to you, my God, for our iniquities have risen higher than our heads, and our guilt has grown up to the heavens." Listen, it is to the remorseful. It is to the person who actually is sorry about their sins and grieve over them. Those are the ones that have a great chance to experience forgiveness of God. In comparison, listen to what Jeremiah the prophet said in Jeremiah 6, verse 15. "Were they ashamed when they had committed abominations? No, they were not at all ashamed, nor did they know how to blush. Therefore they shall fall among those who fall. At the time I punish them, they shall be cast down, says the Lord." Do I got to convince this crowd today that we are living in the midst of a society that is sinning and they are no longer blushing? Is that right, church? And when I was a young child, I knew of a culture. I knew of a society. And I'm not talking about that long ago that they did not used to strut their sins down Main Street and they used to blush over their sins, but no more. No longer are they blushing. They are arrogantly flaunting their sins. And the Bible brings a strong warning that those who fall among those who fall. And God says they shall be cast down. So we have before us a generation today that have no guilt and no shame of their sin. Listen, we ought to fear sin as if it was some contagious disease. You know, I think about this past week. Would you believe that my wife had the audacity? She wouldn't kiss me last week. How many of y'all believe that? I don't blame her. I wouldn't want this stuff that I had, but she wouldn't kiss me. She wouldn't do it. I had all the cruds and stuff going on. I don't blame her. You know, we see people out in public today. They're either wearing a mask because they're sick and they don't want to infect nobody else, or they're not sick and they don't want nobody else to infect them. And so you see people who illustrate perfectly what our approach should be to sin. You see, we ought to treat sin like it's a dreadful, disastrous disease, because guess what? That's exactly what it is. So there is the sin that brought shame, but then there is the sin they tried to tame. Notice verse 7 says they tried. It says they sewed fig leaf together and they made themselves coverings. So not only did sin bring guilt, not only did sin bring shame, it instilled in them this crazy idea of we're going to cover up what we did. I shared in Sunday school this morning, as long as I've been living, I've heard this statement made, and I'm going to let you finish it, okay? I'm going to start this, and you finish it. Here we go. You ready? Here we go. Here it is. I got myself into this, and I know more of y'all heard that than the three that said that. I have gotten myself into this, and there's a statement that is the philosophy of man today. Man, I've gotten myself into this, and bless God, I'll get myself out of this. That is theology from hell. You know, let me address the first part of that. That is accurate. I have gotten myself into this. Adam and Eve, they could have said that. They did get themselves into that. The devil did not cram that fruit down their throat. Listen, it had nothing to do with the fruit on the tree. It had everything to do with the pear on the ground. Okay? Don't talk about, oh, it was an apple, Brother John. I don't give a rip what it was. It had nothing to do with the branches and leaves and the location of the tree. It had everything to do with the pear that was on the ground. And so listen, they tried to cover up their own guilt, tried to cover up their own shame. I want you to know today, the Bible, not Brother John, not the Baptist denomination, the Bible teaches us that if we try to cover up our sins,
God will uncover our sins and expose us. But if we uncover our sins in confession to the Lord, the Bible says that God will cover our sins with the atoning blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Proverbs 28, verse 13, he who covers his sins, get this, will not prosper. But whoever confesses and forsakes them, they will have mercy. You can go down to Lowe's or Home Depot or any of the True Values, and what they have built is a do-it-yourself, repair places. I don't like places like that because, I cannot do it myself. I can tear some stuff up. If you need a demolition man, I'm the guy. But if you need somebody to build something back, don't call me, okay? But Adam and Eve were the first ones to put together a do-it-yourself religion. Bible says in verse 7, they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. Why? Because they were guilty. Why? Because they were ashamed. Why? They tried to cover it up. I'm convinced maybe the first few minutes or hours, all was looking well, all was lovely. I'm assuming that maybe it kind of unfolded like this, that Adam looked over at Eve and he might have made a statement, oh, Eve, those leaves, they'd bring out the green in your eyes. That's a beautiful leaf skirt you got there. Eve might have said to Adam, you're so handsome decked out in that mossy oak camo tuxedo. You wear that good, Adam. Oh, man, things might have been going good. And they might have thought they were successful at covering up what they had gotten themselves into. But can I tell you that if you try to build something at your house, if you try to fix something at your house, and if you do not have the permits, and if you do not do it by the codes, can I tell you that when the inspector comes by, he will ruin your day? Can I get a witness? And listen, I don't speak from experience because I don't try to build stuff, okay? I don't go there. I have heard stories of others who have, though. If you try to do something, you try to build, fix, modify, enhance, whatever, and you don't have the proper permits and codes, the inspector will come by and he'll ruin your day. Here is the main problem with a do-it-yourself religion. God has never given anybody a permit to try to fix yourself. You know why? Because it is not possible. None of us can fix any of us. Listen, you can't fix your neighbor. You cannot fix your friends. You cannot fix your coworkers. You cannot fix your spouse. You cannot fix your children. And can I go the extra mile and say, you cannot even fix yourself? I cannot fix myself. What we have is a self-inflicted wound called sin. The Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Yes, we've gotten ourselves into this, but no, we cannot get ourselves out of this. But the great news is those who are in Jesus Christ, they are part of the redeemed race. And yes, we have messed things up. Man has messed things up. But the God-man who stepped into humanity, he came and fixed what the first Adam messed up. So the problem with the do-it-yourself religion is that God has never permitted anybody to fix themselves. Notice verse 8 and 9 and 10. These, in my estimation, are very sad passages of Scripture. The Bible says they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called Adam and said to him, "Where are you?" So he said, "I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." Why do I say these are very sad passages to me? Because this, for the first time in the history of man, was mankind separated from God. I'm convinced every day God walked with Adam and Eve. Preacher, what does that look like? I don't know. I wasn't there. But one of these days, I promise you, by the grace of God, I will also walk with him. Yes, I've been walking with him for 21 years in a spiritual sense because he's in me and I try to follow him and follow after him. But one of these days, I will walk with Jesus. You okay with that? One of these days, because I am part of the redeemed race, I will be with God in heaven and I'll walk with him one of these days. But the sad part is that for the very first time in the history of mankind, man is now separated from God. What is sin's companions? Guilt, shame, and separation. They were separated from God. And I can imagine I can imagine when Adam and Eve staring at each other in their leaves, congratulating each other for how they tried to improve themselves. All of a sudden, God steps in, and they hear God's voice, and they start diving into the bushes trying to hide from God. But they could not stay hidden from God. They were totally exposed. Somewhere off to the side, I can see this with my mind's eye. Somewhere off to the side, that old serpent, he was over there congratulating himself. Why? Because he had completed what he come to do. What he come to do? The enemy come, the devil, Satan tried. He come to drive a wedge in between God and man, and that is exactly what he did. He divided, he conquered, he drove that wedge and separated man from God. Where are you going with this, preacher? I'm going right here today. I want to say this flat-footed, and I will never apologize for what I'm about to say, but if you are not where you should be in your relationship with God, understand this. The devil is off to the side somewhere congratulating himself because he has successfully driven a wedge in between you and God. I say this to you, sir. I say this today to you, ma'am. Stop giving the devil the opportunity to rejoice, and whatever sin you might be harboring in your heart or in your life, come and confess it before the Lord Jesus Christ today. Stop trying to cover up your own selves. Yes, you've gotten yourself into it, but bless God, you cannot get yourself out of it. Let God cover you with the blood of Jesus. Please note also in this text that Adam did not go looking for God. God came looking for Adam. It is always God who takes the initiative. Always. It is always God who takes the initiative. God comes in and says, Adam, where are you? He said, I was afraid. God says, have you eaten from the tree of which I've commanded you? Listen, God knew the answer to those questions. You understand that, right? God was not fishing for information. He was seeking a confession. Does that make sense? God knew they ate of the tree. When God said, where are you? It's not like he was playing hide and go seek. Oh, come out, wherever you are. Adam, where are you? Oh, I'm getting tired of this. Oh, come on out now. I'm tired of looking for you. No. God knew where they were at, but he wanted them to know where they were at. They were lost and separated from God. But God came looking for them, seeking a confession, but guess what he got? All he got was accusations. So sin, it causes shame. Notice the sin they tried to tame and cover up themselves, but then there's the sin they tried to blame. Notice verse 12. Then the man said, the woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I ate. And the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me and I ate. So the Lord God said to the serpent, watch this. The shame turned to blame. And so Adam said to God, and this is pretty audacious. This is pretty doggone audacious. He said, God, it's your fault. He said, God, I blame you. It's the woman you gave me. God, you didn't give me the right woman. Adam, there's not many other to choose from. She's it, bro. Okay, that's all you're getting. So he said, God, it's your fault. It's the woman you gave me. God looked at Eve. What did Eve do? Eve, she just kept passing that buck right on down the line. He said, oh, God, you know, it's not my fault. It's the serpent's fault. So if you follow the chronological order, Adam blamed God, Adam blamed Eve, Eve blamed the serpent, and the serpent didn't have a leg to stand on. Hey, can I tell you that God hasn't changed not even one degree since that day? God, let that sink into your spirit today. God has not changed one degree since that day. And here's what I mean. God, he was seeking them, he was calling them, and he was searching for them. And he didn't come in like a policeman. He didn't come in like a sergeant ready to destroy them. No, he came in as a compassionate, benevolent God wanting to restore them. So when I got on my little bullet points a while ago about, hey, if you're here today and there's still sin in your life, hey, stop making the devil rejoice and so on forth and so other. Understand this, God is not he's not the sheriff of heaven that just wants to destroy you. He wants to restore you today. God wants to cover you today. God wants to restore you. God was seeking them, calling them, and searching for them. And if that was you today, if you fit into this criteria of one who is harboring your sin, hiding from God, God is still seeking, God is still calling, God is still searching today. The Bible says in Luke 19:10 that for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save those who are lost. But you need to hear today, you need to hear these words today, that one of these days God will call for the final time. One of these days, God will knock for the final time. Listen to this little short poem. There's a time I know not when, there's a place I know not where, that marks the destiny of men to heaven or despair. There's a line by us not seen that crosses every path. It is the hidden boundary between God's mercy and God's wrath. Friends, let me encourage you. Stop playing the blame game. You may be here today with a messed up life, and you're still blaming everybody else for it. You're blaming your parents for it. It's their fault that you wound up the way you are. Can I tell you? Adam and Eve didn't have any parents, and they still messed up. Some of you might say, well, it was my environment, preacher. If I just had a better environment, I would have turned out better. There could not have been a better environment than paradise. Adam and Eve were in an age of innocence before the fall. They lived in paradise in the Garden of Eden. There could be no more perfect environment, and yet they still fell. Stop playing the blame game. Listen, I am not being so cold-hearted that I would ever say that your past has not affected you where you are today. I'll say this, though. You cannot change what happened in your past. You cannot change what got you to here. You can change where you go from here. You do not have to be a product of your past. You do not have to live in defeat, and you do not have to let your past paralyze your presence. Stop playing the blame game. You see, mankind constantly wants to make an alibi. Man wants to believe that he is ill but not evil. Mankind wants to believe that he's sick but not sinful. And he wants to believe that he's weak but not wicked. Listen, nothing has changed in the past 6,000 years. Satan is still trying to keep people away from God. People are still sinning and making excuses for their sins. Sin still has eternal consequences, and God is still looking for those who are hiding from him. That is verse 15 today. And I will put enmity, God is speaking here. He said, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. You need to understand something. That verse 15 is known, it is recognized by scholars as proto-evangelium. That is the word they use for them. It's a big old $3 word, but here's what it means. Prototype means first. Evangelium means gospel. Genesis 3:15 is the first gospel that we ever hear. Listen, when you hear about the first gospel, it's not Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. The first gospel was preached by God, and the first congregation was Adam and Eve. But you see, God, the first gospel was preached, the first prophecy was given by God, and it was concerning his son Jesus. Notice that I will put enmity, meaning there will be a battle between the seed of man and the seed of woman. He said, and between your seed and, notice your Bible, it says, and her seed. Look at your neighbor and say, her seed. Can you say it a little louder? I didn't hear you. Her seed. When the old rabbis would read that, they would scratch their heads. You know why? Because when you read of procreation in the Bible, over 100 times, it refers to the seed of the man, not the woman. So the seed is in the man, and the egg for fertilization is in the woman. So when the old rabbis would read Genesis 3:15, and then say, they'd look and they'd say, good night, the seed, her seed, the seed woman, they would think to themselves, that's not right. What does that mean? Was that an accident? Is that a mistype? Oh, no. There are no mistypes in the scripture. Friend, you know what you have here? What we have here is the first reference to the virgin birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. The very first reference to the virgin birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Preacher, we're coming up on Christmas here in a few months. Matter of fact, 98 days left. Not that I'm counting, but 98 days. All right. Squirrel, I seen that squirrel. I'm back now. The first gospel ever preached was here. And so listen, it's the first reference to the virgin birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Preacher, I don't think the virgin birth is important. Listen, if you remove the virgin birth from your theology, your salvation will fall like a house of cards. Why is that? Because God knew 6,000 years ago when mankind fell in the garden that we needed a substitute. God knew back then that we needed a substitute. And listen, not any substitute would do. It needed to be a sinless substitute. Moses was a man of God, but he could not be the substitute. You know why? He had an earthly daddy. What does that mean? That means he had the DNA of sin in him. Abraham was a man of God. He could not be that substitute. You know why? He had an earthly mom and dad. That means he had the DNA. He had sin in him from Adam and Eve. David was a great man of God. The Bible says he was a man after God's own heart, but he was disqualified. You know why? Because he had a mom, an earthly mom and dad. He was disqualified because he had the DNA of sin in him. We can go all through the Old Testament and New Testament, and we finally find a substitute who is a sinless substitute because Jesus had no earthly father. There was no seed of a man in him. The seed, as the angel Gabriel said, is not a seed of man. It is a seed. It has been planted by the Holy Spirit of God. It is the Immaculate Conception, and that is why it is so important that we never remove the virgin birth from the salvation story, because if we do that, if we try to give him an earthly father, we have someone who is disqualified to be our Savior. But because Jesus was virgin born, we know he's the only substitute worthy to save anybody. Notice there's a bruising that's going to take place. The birth and then the bruising. He shall bruise your head, and he shall bruise his heel. He's a serpent. The devil's a serpent. Where does a serpent strike at? The heel, right? You're walking through the woods. Serpent strike at your heel. When Jesus was here, stay with me now. When Jesus was here, walking this earth, the last few days of our Lord's life, that old serpent, the devil, reached out with those fangs, and he struck at Jesus and injected into him the bitter, burning venom of sin, and he bruised Jesus' heel. The Bible says, he who knew no sin became sin for us. So on the cross, Jesus suffered, not as a sinner, but because he became sin for us. So on the cross, this prophecy, part of it became fulfilled. Because on the cross, the death of Jesus, Satan bruised his heel. He struck at his heel, wounded him mortally, and he died because he became sin for all of us. But oh, friends, please, if you would lean in just a little bit, I want you to understand that the latter part of this prophecy is going to be fulfilled, that one day, when Jesus returns, he will crush the head of the devil fatally and finally forever. Paul says in Romans 16:20, and the God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. Hey, I was reading a story about a group of ladies who got together and they was having a discussion, and they got to talking about the subject was the body of Christ. And one of the ladies, she said this. She said, "Oh, I would love to be his heart so I can love as he loved." One lady said, "Oh, I would love to be his eyes so I can see and understand as he does." One dear saint said, "Oh, I'd love to be his ears so I can hear as God hears everybody." But, I got to tell you that one, the last dear saint that spoke up, and she said these words. She said, "Friends, I've lived a long life, and all of my life the devil has been pursuing me." She said, I want to be one of the feet of Jesus so that when he comes back, he will use me to crush Satan's head. I like that. I close with this story. A few years back, George Bean from Palmdale, California, stopped at a local Burger King, ordered 4 hamburgers. Total bill was $4.33. He proceeded to the checkout line at the drive-thru, and kind of absent-mindedly, the worker there punched in the numbers again without erasing the original numbers, creating a bill of $4,334.33. Without noticing the error, he handed over his card. She swiped it, and he was charged over $4,000 for 4 hamburgers. When the newspaper got a hold of the story, they titled this incident, quote, "The most expensive meal in history." I don't know how true that is. I'm sure people pay a lot more for food in other countries in certain meetings. But I know of one meal that was definitely more costly than overpriced hamburgers. And that was the meal that Adam and Eve had in the Garden of Eden. What it cost them? Everything. Everything. You know, but this doesn't end on a sad note. It's not on a sour note. You could read the remaining of chapter 3 and find out that God evicted them out of the garden, not necessarily because he punished them for the rest of their lives, but if you read the text, you're going to find out that God, in mercy, evicted them from the garden. Why? Because if they would have stayed there and ate of the tree of life, they would have lived forever in their sinful condition. And so God evicted them from the garden, put the flaming swords of the cherubim there to guard them so they could not come back in, eat the tree of life, and live in sin forever. Can I tell you, friends, that it is not the will of God for you to live as a sinner forever. God makes a way of redemption. And if you read the ending of chapter 3, the Bible says that those fig leaves were removed and God took the initiative once again and he covered them with what? Skins. He covered them with animal skins. What does that mean? Is there any significance to that? Absolutely. That tells us that an innocent animal who had nothing to do with them disobeying God, an innocent animal that had nothing to do with the fall of man, had to be killed so that their sins could be covered. Most of you know what I'm about to say. I'm going to say it anyways. The picture of the cross is the picture of an innocent Lamb of God who was not responsible for our choice, but he chose to do what he did so that we can be in a place like this and choose to say yes to the Lord Jesus Christ. Friends, listen. You are not here by accident. I understand somebody may have invited you here today, and you come maybe just out of obligation. Maybe you're tired of hearing this person invite you to church, and you just want to shut them up. Well, praise God. You're here, but you're not here by accident. God has you here. Maybe he's already identified to you. You realize that you are part of Adam's ruined race, but you don't have to leave that way. You can leave being part of the redeemed race, but you must be born again. How do I do that? God is extending his gift of grace to you. But if you would just in faith reach out, in faith say yes to the Lord Jesus Christ, invite Christ to be your Savior, you can be saved. Preacher, that sounds so easy. Yeah, I know it is. It is. Listen, God wants to put salvation not on the top shelf just so the elite can reach it. just so the intellectual brainiacs can figure out how to be saved and reach it. No, God put salvation on the bottom shelf so that senior adults can be saved, middle-aged adults can be saved, young adults can be saved, students can be saved, and children can be saved. Listen, the message of the gospel is come to Jesus. Friend, would you come to Jesus today? Heads bowed and eyes closed. The Bible says in Romans 10:9, that if you would confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Friends, I'm going to call upon you today to take the next step. Yes, you believe in Jesus. But friends, has there been a moment when you have received Jesus? That makes it personal. Believing is general. Most everybody believes in Jesus, but not everybody has received Jesus. Sir, ma'am, today, I'm so happy. I'm excited for some of you because God, he is calling you today, and you're off in the bushes somewhere spiritually, and you're trying to come in under the radar and just get through this service, and you can get on out of here unscathed. But, oh, God is calling you. He is saying, and you know he's calling you. He's called you by name. I can't do that. There's no way I can survey any crowd and start calling people out by name to be saved. God knows you. He's calling you. He's seeking you. He's searching you. Will you come to him today in faith? If you're ready to put your faith in Jesus, if you are ready, and if you are just tired and done of being just associated and a part of being just part of the ruined race, you'll be part of the family of God. Today, you can have a spiritual birthday. You can be born again. Friends, I want to lead you in a prayer of repentance. This here will give you opportunity to place your faith in Jesus. I want to lead you in this prayer. Pray after me, but don't pray to me because I can't save you. Only God can. Make this your prayer and pray it with your heart. Are you ready? Heavenly Father, I admit that I'm a sinner. I need to be saved, and I want to be saved. Only you, Jesus, can save me. Today, I receive you as my Savior and as my Lord. With your help and your strength, I will live for you for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. Hey, if you can stand, if you can physically stand, please stand with us today. And if that was your prayer, if that was your desire, would you come and meet me down here? I promise you, I'm not going to infect you with anything that I have. I'm not going to give you anything that I have. The only thing I want to give you is Jesus. Had somebody ask me before, are you in sales? I said, no, I'm not trying to sell anything. I just want to give stuff away. And I got the best thing to give away, and that's Jesus. Sir, ma'am, if you just prayed that for the first day, today is day one of the rest of your life. You are a new believer in Jesus. Would you come and share with us that new identity? Hey, you know how when we have children, we send out birth announcements. You know why we do that? Because we want everybody to know we got a new one on our hands. We're not ashamed of them. So come today, and this can be your birth announcement that I have received Jesus as my Savior. And if, hey, friends, if you're here today and there are other needs, other prayer concerns you have, don't let them go unnoticed. Come to the Lord today with whatever it may be. But would you come today?
I could do nothing. Without him I truly fail. Without him I would be drifting like a ship without a sail. Jesus, without him I could be dying. Without him life would be hopeless, but with Jesus, thank God, I'm saved. Jesus, oh Jesus, do you know him today? Do not turn.
Friends, thank you so very much for your kind attention here this morning. I want to go back to a statement I just made. And by the way, this is not sermon two, okay? I promise you. But I just want to make a statement that I said that salvation is so simple and so easy. But I want to say this. It is not so easy that God is just going to come to your pew and snatch you up and throw you into heaven, okay? Can God do that? He can do that if he wanted to. But he's not. You know why? Because he's not going to force you to love him. He wants you to choose him. He makes God, listen, he has already done everything he needs to do. He has left heaven. He has even went down into Hades. So it is an accurate statement to say that he has left heaven, overcome hell, and now is seated back at the right hand of God. He has done everything he needs to do, and he gives you the opportunity. The door has been opened for you, but you must walk through the door of salvation. He is not going to pick you up and just throw you into heaven. But if you want to go, you can. But you got to willingly come. Willingly come. And we're not going to sing no more verses today. You know, no more. But understand this. The invitation. The church may end our invitation here. But that does not mean God has ended his invitation to you. His invitation will leave here when you leave here. So I encourage you. If you need to follow through with being saved, call upon the Lord. Listen, you don't necessarily need me there. I would walk you through it again. You can call me, I'll come to you. It does not matter. But I promise you this, wherever you go, God is. And so don't let today end. Don't let the sun go down today without placing your faith in Jesus. Don't let it happen today. Don't live with that regret forever. Hey, before we dismiss, one thing I leave you with. Yesterday, me and Melissa come up here, not necessarily because we're a senior. We're not there yet. So we're younger than that, but we're older than the students that came. But they had a student and senior fellowship yesterday, and it was awesome, okay? They had a wonderful time. Preacher, are you trying to make me feel bad? Yes. Yeah, I am. Listen, so bad that I do not want you to miss the next one. They had a great time. A big old bridge was built yesterday, and not necessarily that there was not one already there, but, you know, they just did not want to assume that we are together as one. We're going to intentionally build that bridge, okay? So be looking for the next meeting, and I encourage you, all of our seniors and students who were not there yesterday, to make sure you put that date down. It was an awesome event. And don't believe me, you can ask any of those that were there yesterday, and they'll confirm that story, okay? All right. Hey, reach out to your neighbor. It has been a blessing to be with you today. Let's sing to the Lord today as we dismiss.
Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is he. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is he. So lift up your banner, let the anthems ring, praises to our King. Great and is the Lord our God, great and